still it.
Cindy Bird still there?
She can't leave until they leave. That's like the best. They passed a law. Didn't you see that under? I don't think that's possible. Yeah, she is not at the VRS website, I'm certain.
Of course, you know you got about 3 years to live.
Good seeing y'all.
That's all right.
All righty.
That was my 3 years.
Yes.
Well, as you know, even though the statute says may, that's not exactly how your clients always read it.
You're not suggesting.
While you're joining us, have you had any chance to run down with Ted what we talked about?
Really?
Pursuant to poses problems. I mean, I think we could fix it with just dropping in a clause that said, you know, may issue pursuant to without making the imminent and substantial required by or, you know, that's not the exact wording, but just, I don't think we have to rewrite the entire thing. I think we could do it with just maybe a clause.
Yep.
Subcommittee to order. Is there any announcements? All right, the first order of business we have before us, we have before us House Bill 1779, Delegate Blossom. He's requested that be passed by today. And is there a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded, we pass it by. All those in favor signify by saying aye. Aye. Opposed? Okay, we'll pass that by for today. So that leaves us with the Delegate Oliver Show.
Thank you all for getting up so early for me. I appreciate it. Mr. Chairman, if I could start with House Bill 1715. This is a real fun one to get your brain wrapped around on a Wednesday morning. But this one deals with revegetation on dams. And so just some background real quick, and I'm looking at the audience. Everybody here knows this, is that in general, woody vegetation on dams isn't a good thing. And so, you know, the woody vegetation, first of all, makes it very hard for the inspector to inspect the dam to make sure it's in good condition. Root balls, if the tree flops over, they can go ahead and hurt the integrity of the dam. And the root penetration can also cause seepage if you're not careful. And so the current code of Virginia reflects this, and so there's an absolute prohibition about having woody vegetation on certain parts of your dam. Alas, that doesn't take into consideration that there are actually dams that are specifically designed to support woody vegetation. And so since there is an absolute prohibition, that's the need for this legislation. And so the specific case and point is a wetland mitigation bank that's located up at Camp Snyder, which is in Gainesville, Virginia. And so this is a wetland mitigation bank that was approved by DEQ. It was approved by the Army Corps of Engineers in Prince William County, and it was constructed in 2000. And I didn't bring enough pictures for everybody, but I'll pass it along. But what's cool about this, you know, you do have pictures, very nice. What's cool is that you can see that on the bottom, you have the dam that was says that you can't have woody vegetation on that dam. And the problem is, if you take the woody vegetation out, the wetland mitigation bank, you actually reduce the nutrient value, you reduce the water quality value and the habitat functions of the facility itself. Russ Baxter with DCR, Mike Rolvan with Wetland Studies and Solutions have been working together on the language that is with you today. Mr. Chairman, we do have a substitute that we'll go ahead and pass out. And I understand there's a slight amendment to the substitute if we want to do all those at the end. But what the language before you does is really just two very, very simple things. It says that the prohibition about woody vegetation won't apply to a structure that's approved as a wetland mitigation bank. And I believe that the amendment will expand that slightly and that all parties are okay with a fee in lieu of facility. Those are two different ways or two different reasons to put in a dam like that. And so woody vegetation would be allowed as long as it's approved by DEQ and as long as it's approved by the Army Corps of Engineers and is subject to a restrictive covenant. There is language in there that says that DCR still retains the ability to tell the dam owner to cut, flush, or grub the vegetation based on a site-specific assessment. And so it essentially gets rid of that outright prohibition, so you have some flexibility. And that makes sure that DCR has that savings clause to come in there just in case there is a need to reevaluate woody vegetation on that dam. So anyway, my understanding is that DCR, Chesapeake Bay Foundation, the American Council of Engineering Companies have all looked at this. They're all good with it. And Mr. Chairman, I would throw it back over to the subcommittee for discussion.
Okay. Before we do that, Delegate, now, forgive me, we have before us a substitute. And what did you cover the tweak?
Have not covered the tweak. And so,
do we want to tweak it and then
adopt
the tweak?
I think that would be great.
Mr. Chairman, members of the subcommittee, I'm Nikki Rodner with the Nature Conservancy. And the tweak that we've asked all the players that they would be okay with, and they have all said they are, is on line 16, after wetland mitigation bank, insert or in lieu fee site.
Or what?
Or in lieu fee site. And as Delegate Bulova said, they are held to equivalent standards. They are regulated by DEQ and the Corps. They're just two ways of doing wetland mitigation. And this would make sure that this covers both.
Okay. Any questions on the substitute or the amendment to the substitute? Okay, is there a motion to adopt the substitute as amended?
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded to adopt the bill, the substitute as amended. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, the bill is amended and the substitute as amended stands before us. Is there any questions from the committee? I have one. Delegate Bulova, just certainly don't want to muddy the waters. Pardon the pun. Is there any concern about what kind of woody? I see the design that accounts for the woody, something that gets planted there. But is there anything that somebody could plant that could have such outreaching root systems as to do damage?
Yeah, and Mr. Chairman, I think probably the best thing to do is to ask Mike Rolvan with Wetland Studies and Solutions to answer that question, because it's a good one. I want to make sure I don't get it wrong.
It's a good answer. A good question. I'm Mike Rolvan from Wetland Studies, Cabot, Virginia, and actually designed this project originally for Disney in 1993, and we built it with Boy Scouts in 2000. But we designed it for woody vegetation. We did actually plant woody vegetation. It was actually required by DEQ and the Corps, so it was all intentional. We can have volunteer species, volunteer trees grow. It's not bad, but we don't want them to get to the tree definition. So that's Army Corps definitions 3 inches diameter and 20 feet tall. At that point, we flush cut them with a chainsaw. So, no, I think we have to worry.
Anyone in the audience wishing to speak in favor of the measure? Anyone wishing to speak in favor? Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, my name is Russ Baxter. I'm Deputy Director of the Department of Conservation and Recreation, and the administration is in support of this bill, and we've worked closely with the patron and the proponents of the bill to ensure that it retains our discretion in the event, as you just described, if there's something that got a little bit out of control and jeopardized the safety of the dam. DCR still has the authority to come in that site specific situation and take care of it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Okay, anyone wishing to speak in opposition to the measure? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Okay, seeing.
Move to report.
Second.
All right, it's been properly moved and second to report the substitute as amended. Any further discussion from the committee? All those in favor, do we vote on the bill?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Indicate on the voting, please. Okay, the motion to report is 7-0. Close the board, please. Thank you. Okay, delegate follow-up.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. So the next one is House Bill 1822. I do believe we have an amendment for this one as well. Mr. Chairman, we will pass out copies of this line amendment, but I'll go ahead and read it. For House Bill 1822, on line 69, after the word funding, we would strike the phrase and be in parens and insert this new phrase, semicolon, be in parens, diverts wastewater to a receiving treatment works that is capable of achieving compliance with its nutrient reduction or ammonia control discharge requirements and results in a net reduction in total phosphorus, total nitrogen, or nitrogen-containing ammonia discharges, and little c in parens. And Mr. Chairman, it's really, really hard to describe what that does without the context of the rest of the bill. So if you want me to describe the bill, then we can take up the amendment afterwards.
Yeah, that's a great idea, Governor. I think give us the whole picture. Yeah. All
right. So, Mr. Chairman and members of the subcommittee, this is House Bill 1822 dealing with the Water Quality Improvement Fund. And so I think we're all aware of the enormous cost of meeting the Chesapeake Bay requirements. This bill won't solve that. That would be really cool if we could do that at 7:30 in the morning on a Wednesday. But it does allow us to get some better handle on the cost and then also using some of our state funds a little bit more efficiently. So there's really two big things that this bill does. And so the first part, if you look there on the line 66 through 73, is dealing with point source water quality improvement fund grants. And so these are basically grants to wastewater treatment facilities to reduce their nutrients. And so currently in the code, when you receive or in order to receive a water quality improvement grant, the improvement itself actually has to be the technology installed at the facility itself. So it has to be at that actual physical plant. However, there's a number of localities, and I have Chris Pomeroy with Aqualaw who can speak to this, who have actually found that you can get more bang for your buck by taking the distribution system, so your sanitary sewer pipes, and taking it, and instead of going from one facility that might have less nutrient reduction capability and actually putting that and diverting it to a wastewater treatment facility that's more efficient and has capacity. So, instead of actually installing new technology at one of those plants, the simple act of diverting that sanitary sewer from one facility to another one will actually wind up with better nutrient reduction at less cost. But because of the way that the current language is written in the code, it would not allow you to be able to get funding for that kind of innovation. And so that's what this bill does. It just provides specific authorization for DEQ to allow this. And what the amendment does is further state that you have to demonstrate that the receiving plant has capacity, permanent capacity, and that there's actually going to be a net reduction. And so we thought that was applied with the term may, that the director may do this, but we wanted to put in a little bit of a safeguard to say, hey, if we are going to do this, you do have to demonstrate that you got that capacity, and you have to demonstrate that you can get a net nutrient reduction. So this is permissive, but hypothetically allow us to get those nutrient reductions at less cost. The second one is the end parts from line 91 on through. And so these are two very, very related items. And so, Mr. Chairman, I know that you know, and I know that Matt and Bob know that the agricultural needs assessment, the agricultural BMP needs assessment that we do each year, the DCR does each year, is extraordinarily valuable with regard to setting a benchmark for what do we need to do in order to improve water quality. And so we don't always meet the expectations of what we these assessments say that we need. It usually says we need a lot more than ultimately we're able to fund, but it provides really, really solid information for the governor's staff and also our appropriators so that they have a benchmark from which to aim for in order to be able to fully fund the needs of our agricultural BMPs. And this was actually put into the Code of Virginia by Delegate Landis back in 2009 as part of the Water Quality Improvement Act. And so what this bill does is have DEQ do a similar assessment for stormwater and point source and wastewater. And so again, we've got some extraordinary needs coming up with respect to stormwater, for example, in order to meet our 2025 Chesapeake Bay restoration goal. Last year we put in $20 million. This year there's a proposal for $50 million. They're really kind of shots in the dark in terms of how much do we actually need. And so this is really a good way for us to step back, similar to what we do with agricultural BMPs, and have DEQ do that assessment of what is the need that's out there so that our budgeters, our appropriators can get a better sense of what ought to be aiming for with respect to funding. This is something that I've had some good discussions with DEQ and Secretary Strickler. I don't know that at the secretary level they've had a chance to say absolutely yes. That takes a little bit more time. But we've worked very closely with David Paler, and he's the one who came up with that additional language. The other groups that are in support are the Virginia Association of Stormwater Management Agencies, Chesapeake Bay Foundation supports. And if you have any questions, again, we have Chris Pomeroy from ANSA who can come up and ask them. But that's what the bill does in a nutshell, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. So with that explanation, it puts the amendment into a better perspective. So let's, can I have a motion to move the amendment?
So moved.
Second. Move and second that we adopt the amendment. To House Bill 1822, all those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? So the bill before us is amended. The delegate's done a great job in explaining what it is. Any questions from the committee?
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Ferris.
All right, I guess I move to pass the amendment, but this is a question. So on line 69, little B would then become little C, because
yes. Scott says yes.
Okay. Because it doesn't, I just want to make sure. So we're not deleting the original little B, we're just making that
correct.
representing the Virginia Municipal Wastewater Association, Stormwater Associations, and just like to briefly add that about 20 years now since the Water Quality Improvement Act was adopted up here. Just a quick observation is that when we first got started down this road, the obvious thing to do was to upgrade all of the larger wastewater treatment plants. The House of Delegates has been tremendously supportive of that effort over the years, as has this committee, and really leading the way on the policy for that. Looking ahead into the future with those larger upgrades really done, yet more work to do toward the bay restoration and other water quality improvement across the state. The larger, most obvious things on the to-do list have largely been done. And this is one of these updates that will help us continue to work smarter, be more cost-effective as we go forward, as this program reaches down into smaller facilities all across the state, not just for Chesapeake Bay nutrients, but for nitrogen-containing ammonia statewide. So the efficiency opportunities that will relieve some constraints on DEQ right now. By the way, he's also been an excellent partner in looking for cost-effective, smart engineering solutions over the years. This will give them some more latitude to continue in that vein. So we support the bill for those reasons. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chris McDonald, Virginia Association of Counties. We support the bill and thank the delegate for his hard work on this issue.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak in favor of the measure?
Mr. Chairman.
Delegate Blossom.
So just for clarification, we're aiming at two issues. The first one is the pipeline. And the second one is to allow assessment.
I wouldn't phrase that first one. Like this.
Thank you, Delegate Blossom, for that shot over the bow.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. This is Peggy Sandler, Chesapeake Bay Foundation. And as Delegate Bulova said, we support this bill. I just want to note, in addition to Delegate Bulova's comments, one reason why we support this bill is, in particular, it's a prescription of the needs assessment for stormwater. I can't tell you how many times, perhaps many of you, and certainly other legislators have said, well, how much money are we going to need for stormwater? And over the years, we and many others have worked to answer this question, which ends up being more difficult than it seems like it should be at first blush. We're very excited that this bill's going in to include that. I think it will help all of the policymakers in the state to make good decisions about this important need. So thank you for putting it in, and we do support the bill.
Thank you. Anyone else wish to speak in favor of the measure? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Anyone in opposition? Seeing none, yes. I've been instructed that if this bill is to report, that it has to be reported and referred to appropriations. So, Delegate Blossom, can I report and refer? The motion is to report and refer to appropriations. Is there a second? It's been properly seconded.